stand as we worship the Lord this morning. It says, let us come and sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. So we'd like to encourage you to let us praise and come with joy as we worship the Lord this morning. Yeah. blessing and honor, glory and power, be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Blessing and honor, blessing and honor, glory and power, be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days.
Yeah.
Blessing and honor, blessing and honor, glory and power, be unto the Ancient of Days. From every nation, all of creation, bow before the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. Every tongue, every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. In worship you will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days. Shall reign over all the earth, sing unto the Ancient of Days. For none can compare to your matchless worth, sing unto the Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth, sing unto the Ancient of Days. None can compare to your matchless worth, sing unto the Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth, sing unto the Ancient of Days. Come on, sing it with me. For none can compare to your matchless worth, sing unto the Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth, sing unto the Ancient of Days. For none can compare to your matchless worth, sing unto the Ancient of Days. Every tongue in heaven and earth shall declare your glory. Every knee shall bow at your throne. You will be exalted, O God, and your kingdom shall not pass away, O Ancient of Days, O Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. For none can compare to your matchless worth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. For none can compare to your matchless worth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. Your kingdom shall reign over all the earth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. For none can compare to your matchless worth. Sing unto the Ancient of Days. We worship you, Lord.
A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. And if you've been forgiven, and if you've been
must cry. Oh, holy, oh, holy, you are lifted high. Oh,
and lifted up. He is an awesome God. And he is the great I Am. We sang that song earlier where we called him the Ancient of Days. And I reflected on that. You know, God is forever. And often we wanna try to think of God and remember what he said his name was. He says, my name is I Am. He doesn't have a birthday. He's not old. He's not young. He is. And he wants you to know this good news today. On this Sunday, this day that we rest, he wants to invite you and me to enter into his rest. To know that the work has been done. The striving is over. I don't know about you, but often I find myself feeling like I'm striving. I've got so many things to do, so many projects or things I'm trying to achieve, and they can seem like elusive. They're far off, and there's this inability to really relax or rest, because if I'm resting, I'm not achieving. And God reminds us in the book of Hebrews that it has been achieved. You don't have to achieve anymore. There's nothing more that you can do to gain your salvation, to gain the hope that we hold on to. It is finished. That's what Jesus declared on the cross. And so we can rest today knowing that the striving is over. And we can celebrate and know this awesome God who is. He was and is to come. And we look forward to that day when Christ returns and we can just experience that rest like never before. Heavenly Father, we worship you today, O God. What an awesome God you are. You deserve all glory and honor and praise, Lord God. And Lord, we thank you as we just celebrated your death and resurrection, oh God. We are reminded on this Sunday after Easter, Lord God, that it is finished, Lord. The work has been completed. And God, we just pray that you would help us to continue to walk in faith, walk in obedience, not to earn your grace or your favor or your love, but Lord, just to experience the life that you have for us, oh God. Lord, we thank you for the work that you've done in us and the work that you are continuing to do, Lord God. And we just pray that you would work in mighty ways in our lives, Lord God. Lord, we pray that you would touch us where we need physical healing, oh God. Lord, you said that you can intervene in this world today, Lord, and bring health and wholeness. So, Lord, we think of those like Helen Roberts, who's in the hospital today. Lord, we pray that you would touch her body and renew her strength, oh God. Lord, we lift up Tom Richardson in this battle against cancer, oh God. Lord, we pray that you would just minister to him and draw near to him, oh God. And Lord, continue to bring healing to Melanie as she recovers from surgery, oh God, with her hip. I just pray for your physical touch, Lord God. We know there's so many other needs, God, and you are more than able and willing. And we just pray that you would do miracles among us, oh God. Lord, we pray that you would give us a peace of mind and a peace of heart that goes beyond our understanding, Lord. Touch those who are dealing with fear and anxiety and frustration, oh God. And Lord, continue to meet our needs. Lord, you are our great provider. Lord, help us not to worry, but Lord, help us to remember what you told us, that you take care of the sparrows, Lord. You will definitely take care of us, Lord God. So we just trust you in that today. Lord, thank you for your Holy Spirit. Have your will and your way among us today. And we just pray that you will be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Welcome to Meadowbrook Community Church. If you're a guest here today, thanks so much for joining us. If you would, please check out the connection card that says welcome in front of you. We would love to be able to connect with you and get to know you a little bit later on this week. If you're online, thanks for tuning in, and please try to connect with us as well. Well, if you got communion cup this morning, we are going to do communion at the end of the service, so just know that is going to be happening a little bit later. If you haven't got one, you might want to grab one. But we are excited today as We are going to see 7 different people get baptized this morning. Yes, we've got, yes, amen. God has really been doing some great things in people's lives. And so we have 2 this morning in the first service and 5 in the second service. So if you would turn your attention over to the baptismal with Pastor Aaron. Guys, we're so proud of what's happening over there.
All right. Well, hey, good morning, Meadowbrook. All right. Hey, good morning, Meadowbrook. It's such an honor to be with you this morning as we celebrate another baptism, both in this service and next service, like Pastor Kent had said. And it's the one Sunday on occasion I wear my swim trunks at church. It's fantastic. But hey, we're so excited. Baptism is such an important step in our journey of faith with Jesus Christ. Jesus himself said in Matthew 28 to go and baptize and make disciples, right? And so that's what we're doing here today, as declared by Jesus. It's a symbol of both our salvation, of that we die with Christ, as Romans chapter 6 says, and we were both raised in life with him, but also it's an act of obedience today. And we are so excited to have Jeff Hardesty today decide that he wants to be baptized and commit his life to the Lord. So I'm going to ask Jeff now to come to share why he's decided to be baptized today and share part of his story.
I also just wanted the opportunity to wear shorts in church. During the course of my life, I've lost everything I have owned a dozen times over. My cars, my license, my homes, my friends. I've lost loved ones. Hi, I'm Jeff. I'm an alcoholic. I've said those words many a times at many a meeting, never one quite like this. This is an opportunity for a renewal, a refurbishment, replenishment of my spirit and my soul as I rededicate myself to the Lord. Amen. Thank you.
Okay, there you go. Grab your other arm. No. There you go. I got you. Jeff, based upon your declaration of faith, I now baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
There you go, my friend.
Good morning, Meadowbrook. We're so glad you've joined us here today. Here is a quick look at what's happening around Meadowbrook this month. The Spring Carnival is Saturday, April 20th, and we cannot wait to serve the kids and families in our community with an afternoon of games, inflatables, entertainment, and prizes. Now, this carnival is a major outreach event, and we absolutely need all hands on deck to make it a huge success. There are so many great ways to serve our community, and we have made it incredibly easy to sign up to serve. I'm signed up, my kids are signed up to serve, and I can't wait to see my Meadowbrook family serving together. So make sure you stop by the carnival table in the foyer or scan the QR code in the bulletin to choose an area to serve, and let's make this year's carnival even better than last year's. Real Life Marriage Uncensored is coming up on April 26th and 27th. This marriage weekend is a great way to spend time with your spouse and to invest in your marriage. The cost is $60 and will include in-depth teaching, an interactive date night, snacks, and breakfast on Saturday. Registration is open and available through the Meadowbrook app and the website. For more information, you can contact Pastor Kent at khollis@meadow.org. And finally, Meadowbrook will be sponsoring 2 missions trips this year, and we want to share those opportunities with you. Pastor Cooper will be leading the family missions trip to Omaha, Nebraska, August 2nd through the 5th. Now, this trip is a great entry-level trip that includes serving with back-to-school supplies, working at an animal therapy petting zoo, and a stop at the Omaha Zoo. There will be an informational meeting today at noon in room 151 for those who are interested in this awesome trip. Meadowbrook's second mission trip opportunity will take place November 7th through the 16th. This international trip to Indonesia will be led by Pastor Kent and will include working with AG World Missionaries Jamie and Tasha Kemp. Now, Jamie and Tasha are looking forward to working with our team in the areas of building relationships with Muslims and young professionals through English conversation. If you are interested in this international trip, there will be an information meeting next Sunday at noon in the Orange Bowl.
Well, it is great to see you here on this Sunday that we continue to rejoice as we enter into a new month. And this month of spring just speaks of life and truly life that we have in Christ. The carnival, spring carnival, is definitely coming up. It's about 2 weeks away, and we're looking forward to that. And I have been told that we really do need people to sign us, specifically volunteers, to help with setup and takedown. So if you're able to help in that way, you would be an immense blessing. Please let us know about that. We also want to receive the morning tithes and offerings, giving you the opportunity to give to the cause of Christ. We give the first fruits of that which we have been given, that is the tithe, and also missionary faith promise offerings. Through your faithful giving, we truly are able to advance the cause of Christ here as well as around the world. So we don't take your faithfulness and giving for granted. Thank you so very much. We're beginning a new series this morning, and that series is from the book of Revelation, the first couple chapters, as we address the seven churches of Asia. At my email address, rstrack@meadow.org, every day I get mail. There is not a day that goes by that I don't get some mail of some kind. I get my share of junk mail for sure. I'm sure you do too. Spam that I have to sort through. I have to be very careful. I don't delete personal mail from you or from family or important business mail, because I get plenty of the other for sure. When you get 25 to 50 emails a day, it's easy to overlook some mail that is important if you're not careful. We better be careful not to hit the delete button concerning the letters God is sending to Meadowbrook and to us personally. You can't delete letters from God. God has sent letters to us that are contained already in His Word. In fact, in the opening of the book of Revelation, Jesus Christ Himself sends letters to seven churches in Asia, Asia Minor. And He refers to the churches as the seven golden lampstands. These letters that He dictated to the Apostle John were not just for seven churches. They were for more than just the seven churches back in Asia Minor. These letters that He dictated were not just for those, but they are for you and for me and for the church today. They are very much alive, these letters, and relevant for our lives as well. And every letter ends, as we study through these letters, with the words, "Everyone who has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches." These letters are just as important today as in the days of the early church. So today, we're going to open the inbox of God's Word, Because Meadowbrook, we've got mail. The contents of the book of Revelation were revealed by Jesus to John while he was banished by the Roman Emperor Domitian to a 10-mile-wide, 6-mile-long island in the Aegean Sea called Patmos. It wasn't exactly the Grand Caymans. It wasn't a tropical island. It was more like Alcatraz. And that's where John lived for 18 months in exile, in prison under the Roman Emperor. So John is essentially in prison on the island of Patmos. He's given a vision, a revelation of Jesus Christ. John sees his glory and says, "When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead." And then Christ puts his hand on John and he says, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore." So Christ, he speaks to his church. And the first letter is addressed to the church in the city of Ephesus. We know a lot about the church at Ephesus. It was a church that had been greatly blessed. Ephesus was a major city. It was significant politically. The home of the Roman governor was right there, and nothing was a bigger draw than the worship of the fertility goddess Diana. The Temple of Diana was one of the 7 wonders of the ancient world. 120 columns, 60 feet high, a magnificent edifice. But the worship of the empress, or the Ephesian Diana, was worse than anything we could imagine. That temple, the Temple of Diana, became a haven for criminals and the center of temple prostitution. Immoral stuff going on, all in the name of religion. It was wild in Ephesus. The worship was a kind of hysteria where the people would work themselves up into frenzies of shameless sexual mutilation. It was in this city amid these conditions that the Apostle Paul had ministered for 3 years, as we learn from Acts chapter 19. The preaching of the gospel was very effective, and it affected the worship of Diana to where sales of idols to the goddess Diana by the temple priests were reduced dramatically. This, plus the influence of the little band of Christ followers who taught that these idols were not worthy of worship, resulted in a riot that resulted in Paul forced to depart from Ephesus. And if you read Acts 20, you'll see where the Apostle Paul, he got down on his knees and he prayed with the elders of the Ephesus church. And he just bawled like a baby because he had to get on a ship and leave them. Paul loved this church. But he left them in good hands. He left them with people like Aquila and Priscilla. Have you heard of them? I mean, Aquila and Priscilla, I wonder how they got together, how they got matched up. Those names just amaze me. They probably wore matching sweatshirts and had his and her bath towels. I'm pretty confident of that. But this was a strong church in Ephesus. It became very influential as a church, highly respected church, an active church. It was a hard-working, hard-charging, hang-on-the-truth-at-all-cost kind of church. The church of Ephesus was about 40 years old when Jesus dictated this letter to John. About the same age, actually, as Meadowbrook Community Church. We're just a little over 40 years old ourselves. So this little You've Got Mail icon pops up, and the message starts like this in chapter 2, verse 1. To the angel at the church of Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. Jesus reminds them right off the bat that he's the head of the church. He's the protector. He's the sustainer. He's the one to whom all the leaders and people of the church are ultimately accountable to. His church, his bride. And he walks among the seven golden lampstands. I think we would be remiss if we missed out on the fact that Jesus still walks among his church today. To think that Jesus would be uninvolved, that he would be unmoved and indifferent by the attitudes and the heartbeat and the condition of his present church would be missing it. He is vitally involved in his church today. The truth is, friends, he walks among us still. And if you know him, that's very, very reassuring. Each letter to the various churches that Jesus sends his letter to includes the phrase, I know. I know. He knows what's going on in his church. He knows what's going on with his people. And this is the backdrop of the letter of John to the church of Ephesus. And it begins with a commendation, an affirmation of Jesus. This is the good news. Jesus commends, he affirms them. Look at all the things he says to them. He says, I know your deeds. I know your hard work. He congratulates them. He applauds them. He praises their strengths. Like Ken Blanchard says in his little book, The 1 Minute Manager, you ought to catch people doing something right. Stop and compliment them. Affirm them. Well, Jesus finds out what they are doing right, and he commends them. He affirms them. I've got some good news and some bad news. Jesus wrote the good news first. There were a lot of good things that were going on in the church of Ephesus. I mean, if you read their newsletter or got on their website, it was an active church. They weren't lazy. They were full of activity, and Jesus tells them, your perseverance, your endurance is legendary. You just won't quit. You keep a good attitude through hardships. Paul warns you that false teachers will show up in your midst, and when they showed up, you would have nothing to do with them. You were able to test the validity of what they were saying and doing, and you exposed them for who they really are. Way to go, Church of Ephesus. In verse 6, he says, you have this in your favor. You hate the practice of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Jesus says, I know it's not easy to stand for truth and purity and morality in a city like the one you live in. Outside your walls, it's pretty wild. These Nicolaitans, I keep thinking of Nickelodeon. I can't get that out of my mind. These Nicolaitans were so-called believers who tried to convince other believers that God's grace was cheap, that it was a license to do whatever you wanted to do. So Jesus writes to the church of Ephesus and says, you know these Nicolaitans are trying to get you to go with the flow of your culture, the flow of what's happening in your city, and still claim to follow me. I can't stand that. My death was not cheap. I paid a high price for you to be holy and blameless and pure. I appreciate the fact that you see through that deceptive teaching and that you can't stand it either. I commend you. Thanks for standing up for the truth. Now imagine sitting in that congregation, the Church of Ephesus, when that letter starts to be read directly from Jesus Christ. You're starting to feel pretty good about yourself. You're sitting there thinking, man, we've got a great church. We're taking a stand against the evil that's in this pagan world. They were probably tempted to break into song. We are the champions. But then the letter takes a turn and you get a knot in your stomach. I can't imagine what it was like for John to write this down, because John, remember, was a former leader in the Ephesian church. Jesus tells them, John, write this down. Verse 4, yet I hold this against you. You don't love me. You've forsaken. You have let go. Literally, you have allowed erosion to occur in your love for me. You do all these things, but they're not motivated any longer by your love and passion for me. The words are arranged in this letter in such a way as not to put the emphasis on the word love, but on the word first. Jesus is telling these people, you lost your first love. You lost that love of first importance. He's saying to them, I'm talking about the initial passion that you had for me that flows out of the gratitude of being saved and changed and given a fresh start. The love that flows out of the fact when you didn't even give a rip about God, I died for you in the middle of your sin. That first passion that made you sing Amazing Grace with tears streaming down your face. The gratitude for the unconditional love that was lavished on you. You didn't sing to me anymore. Oh, there's a song service in your church, but you don't sing to me or for me. He writes, you hardly acknowledge me in your life anymore. You used to be this flaming inferno, but now there's just a pilot light. You've lost your first love that you had for me. It's easy, isn't it, to start serving God without seeking God, to live for God without loving God? I think Jesus is saying to them and to all of us, I want people who have a passion for who I am and not just be a doer. In reading Paul's letter to the Ephesian church, I've noticed in almost every letter in the New Testament, there's a front half of the letter and then there's a second half of the letter. And the epistle to the Ephesians is a wonderful example of that. If you look at the second half of the letter to the church of Ephesus, we're going to skim through this real quickly. You read phrases like, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Put away all falsehood and speak truthfully. In your anger, do not sin. Don't give the devil a foothold. He who has been stealing, steal no longer. Don't let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth. Among you, there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality, any kind of impurity or greed. Be careful then how you live. Submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Children, obey your parents. Put on the whole armor of God so you can take a stand against the devil's schemes. All these verses are about how you're supposed to behave as a Christ follower. But there's a first half of every letter, and we're still in Ephesians. Go back to chapter 1. We'll speed read this as well. He has blessed us in every realm with every spiritual blessing of Christ, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance to the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. May you know him better. I pray also the eyes of your heart be enlightened in order that you may know the hope to which you have been called, the riches of his glorious inheritance. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how long and how high and how wide and deep is the love of Christ. That's how Paul ends the first half of this letter before he launches into the second half about the behavior we're supposed to do. There's a first half and there's a second half. Did you notice that the first half is all about who God is and what he's done for us and who we are in his eyes and how much he loves us? Get to know him. Open the eyes of your heart. Capture that love for him. I pray that you'll be able to grasp how long and high and wide and deep is his love for you. You see, the tendency is, as human beings, is to jump to the second half of the letter. Just tell me what I have to do. Just tell me what I have to do. I want to tell you, that's a lousy checklist for spiritual transformation. Now, those are some healthy things to do. To put yourself in a position where the Holy Spirit can get a hold of your life and start to transform you. But your ultimate goal, our ultimate goal, is not just to look good on the outside. Our goal is to become more like Jesus, to really know Jesus, to love him. Jesus is saying to the church in Ephesus, you jumped to the second half of the letter. You didn't grasp how high and wide and deep and long my love is for you. You started well. Now you live for me without loving me. How do you recapture that first love? How do you recapture that passion? Well, Jesus gives three ways. He tells them simply in verse number 5 of Revelation 2. He says, remember, repent, and return. Remember, repent, and return. Verse 5, remember the height from which you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you don't repent, I'm going to come and remove your lampstand from its place. Remember the height from which you have fallen. I think Jesus is saying, remember how it felt when you first got saved. When you first felt forgiven, when you had a new hope and a new energy and a new life and a new identity surging through you. I think Jesus is saying, go back and remember the pit from which you have been rescued. Remember how much you've been forgiven, because whoever's been forgiven much loves much. Go back and take an honest look at when and where you began to lose your passion for me. Maybe Jesus is asking you, what happened? What happened? What is it that made you lose that passion you had for me? That love for me? Did you just walk too long in the darkness? Was it an addiction that pulled you away from me? Did life just suck it out of you? Did you take your eyes off of me, and particularly through a tough time, and you tried to do it alone? Did you get so busy making money that you forgot that I've given you more riches than you can ever earn? Did you just really get cynical about my church? Did somebody hurt you? When did it happen to you? When did it happen? I think Jesus says, go back. Start grasping who he is and how you met him and how you want to know him. He says, seek me, know me, love me, hang with me, and then you can serve me out of that love relationship. Repent. Remember the height from which you've fallen. Remember and then repent. Are you surprised that Jesus would say, repent? See, I think most Christ followers don't view the absence of a passionate first love for Jesus as really a sin. I think a lot of people view it as simply something that just naturally happens through the years. I used to feel that passion more. I used to feel really close to God, but I'm older now. I'm getting used to this. I'm not as radical as I used to be. I'm more mature. Friends, to that Jesus says, repent. Repent. I couldn't help but reflect over my journey with Christ. In my junior year, I've shared with you before, I came to faith in Christ, and truly, my theme verse became 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone be in Christ, they are a new person. Old things pass away. Behold, all things became new. My life was truly becoming new in him. New attitudes, new thoughts, new goals, new dreams, new passions. I truly found an experience in Christ that gave me a love for God. And that love just was passionate. And I can remember so many different encounters with him where I just found myself overwhelmed by the love of God. Moved into vocational ministry and certainly a love for God. But even serving God, supposedly all full-time, as we all are, but in vocational ministry, I found myself at different times over these past 45 years where I was more of a doer than I was of a lover. And there has been different times where I have had to recall and return back to that first love that I have had for Christ. It happens to all of us, and we're called to return to our first love. If not, then he says, remember the height from which you've fallen and repent. And the good news is that it's not an irreversible condition, or he wouldn't have said these things. We can do a 180, and we can turn from whatever has our affections, and we can return to our first love, the love of most importance. Remember, repent, and return. He says, go back and rediscover the love that you had for me. I'm learning that the most important thing that I can do is to spend time alone with him. You know what Jesus' greatest passion was? You think Jesus' greatest passion was for the lost? You believe Jesus' greatest passion was healing? Was teaching? Jesus' greatest passion was to be with the Father. Everything else flowed out of that intimacy. And I'm learning that intimacy with God is living in the awareness, the constant presence, and awareness that every day you're in the presence, the power, and the love of God. Intimacy with God. It's going through a tough time with Him and growing closer as you go through that tough time. Because nothing quite binds people together like a tough time. God is right there with you. Intimacy with God is laying on an operating room table and saying, God, I'm scared right now, and I would pray for you to heal me. But if you choose to do it another way, either way I win because of you. Friend, intimacy with God is life. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. Jesus says in this letter, you do this and you'll have real life. You'll eat from the tree of life in paradise. He says, if you don't do it, I will come and I will remove you from your lampstand. Now, it doesn't mean that you're going to lose your spot in heaven. It doesn't mean you're no longer a Christian. He says, you'll no longer be a light for me. You'll no longer be effective as a church. If you're not going to burn with passion for me, I will come and remove you from your lampstand. Oh, that Meadowbrook would be a church that is deeply intimate with Jesus Christ. Someone once said, if we don't know God intimately and passionately, we will become like travel agents passing out brochures to places we've never visited. It's easy to be involved in a church and walk at a distance and have your heart grow cold. Jesus may want to say to you this morning, I know your deeds. I know your hard work. I know your knowledge of the Word. I know that you stand up against evil. The way you show up and step up even when you don't feel like it. The way you give of your time. The way you give of your money. But do you love me? Do you love me? Remember the old play Fiddler on the Roof? Remember when Tevye says to Golda, do you love me? And she says, for 25 years I've cooked your meals, made your bed, given your kids something like this, is what he was saying. And he says, singing, but do you love me? And she would come back with a barrage of other things she's done. He'd say, singing, do you love me? Friends, if Meadowbrook is never known for anything else in this world, may she always be known as a place that is head over heels in love with Jesus, where people are passionate about the Savior. May it be always be true of me. May it always be true of you. May you never be ashamed to say it and mean it from the core of your being. I love Jesus Christ with all of my heart, with all of my soul, with all my strength, and with all of my mind. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. We're going to move into a time of communion, and really, what an appropriate passage for us to be challenged with this morning as we think about what Jesus Christ has done. If you have not received your elements, the ushers are going to just come your way, and please just raise your hand and allow them to serve you. But we're talking about a love for Christ. Bible makes it clear, God demonstrated his love for us. And while we were yet sinners, he died for us. I really do think if you want to return to a fresh love, a fresh appreciation and love and gratitude for Christ, it really does begin with reflecting back on the cross. The incredible love. Let's not pass over this easily. The love of Christ. The love of Christ demonstrated through his death. I'd like for you to take the bread representing the broken body, the punishment that was upon him because he loves you. He's broken for you. Loves you so much. I want to encourage you to remember the death of Jesus Christ as we partake together of the bread.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. And then, of course, our redemption is through his precious blood. He shed his blood for the forgiveness of all our sin. And friend, that feeling of feeling forgiven, that feeling of knowing forgiveness, gives us an incredible assurance before God. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. What a wonderful, wonderful experience that is to know you've been forgiven. Even as Jeff has shared in his baptism, all that was a part of his past. But God has redeemed him. He's forgiven him. He's cleansed him by his precious blood. Let's partake together of the cup representing the forgiveness of our sin through his shed blood. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, God, for all that you've done for us. Oh, I pray that you would cause us all right here today to begin that journey of renewing our first love that we had for you. I pray, God, that you would renew my heart, that I would return with a passion that compels me, a love that compels me, knowing how much you truly love me. May I be able to respond with that kind of love for you. Oh, I ask God that you would renew your church, draw us back to that first love. May we serve, Lord, out of a love for you. May our service for you, what we do, God, how we follow you in obedience, be out of that love that we have for you. May God, you help us to be renewed in spirit and heart with a love for you that truly is enduring and passionate. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Would you stand with me, please, as we can conclude our service this morning? I just want to encourage you to open your heart anew and afresh to him and be on a journey here this week of renewing your love for God. I know that that will please him deeply. If you want prayer, you're somehow at a place where there's something, there's a barrier there, you're just stuck, you need help. You need prayer to get through. I want to encourage you to come forward, and on the sides we'll have our prayer team available for you to be prayed for. As they have prayed, they believe that the Lord wants to minister to those with loneliness and addictions and family issues and even just a greater hunger for God's Word. Let's open our heart to the Lord and let's respond through prayer and let's respond here in worship.
Confidence, you never fail me. prayer, yes, please come forward and pray with our prayer team. The altar is always open. You can pray at the altar at any moment. We just had a blessing today. We're so glad that you guys were here with us. Go in the knowledge and the goodness of God and His place in your life. And we just thank you for being here today. God bless you.